so the story just, it's not that engaging. It keeps you from being too engaged with it. Just because it's kind of bad. So, I'd probably say that, you know, it's probably anywhere from 16 to 50%. I don't think it's better than 32%. It's an okay story, but it's really not that great. I'd probably just... It would be safe to say it's a 30% story. My butt hurts. As soon as I finish this review, I'm gonna just find the next place I can stop and put in the numbers, go to the bathroom, maybe eat something. Characters, all right, look, this is supposed to be, on the surface, a character-driven drama, not a comedy, kind of a mystery. I don't know if it really even qualifies as that good of a mystery, but I guess it is a mystery movie. But the characters really aren't that interesting. All right, so you start off with Lynn Dekker. He's doing the main narration, and I'm going to spoil this because at the end of this review, I'm not going to recommend watching it. Lynn Dekker is the perp who commits one murder and attempts another murder along with trying to shoot at the group of police officers arresting him. So he's a psycho. But he's not really a crazy psycho. He is an evil psycho. There's a difference. So I guess he's just evil. And you can take the psycho part out of it. So he's the evil villain, right? He's the antagonist. And he's pretty much the main character in the movie. Aside from the officer, but the officer really isn't doing much of driving the story forward. I mean, he's kind of the catalyst for the changes in events in the story. But, you know, he's not really charismatic or anything. Whereas the other characters in the movie are. He's just kind of a... Mark is just kind of a blank template for... He's just kind of neutral and doesn't react much to stuff. I guess Lynn Dekker is the main source of charisma in the movie. Because Laura, it's like, you know, the way that they set this character up is You know, she's kind of like the character in Pandora's Box. Or she's just like this beacon of purity and compassion and, you know, a source of encouragement and health and inspires others and is a muse. And it's like, ends up just being this really vanilla character, you know, who's doing things that really don't influence the story that much. She's just kind of one character among many, so it's like, the movie's really mistitled, and it could have had a way better title, I'm sure, but, you know, that's kind of giving the movie too much of a benefit of the doubt that it doesn't deserve. So, Lynn Decker. Okay, when they first introduced this character, I mean, if it was any other time period other than the 40s, you'd go, and actually, really, they probably should have, like, used this more if they were actually going to, you know, if it was like a pre-code movie, you know, pre-Hays Code, you know, the kind of vibe that I was getting off of Lynn Decker is that he was a homosexual. So, it's like, okay, you know, the twist there at the end would have been that he's not. And Kevin Smith did something like that in when he was writing a series arc, well, just a story arc for, wow, it is dark over there. That is crazy. If that's because of the cloud cover. I've got more wind resistance. See, it's like, okay, I don't know the difference between, like, whether I'm getting turbulence or whether the car in front of me is actually being a windbreak. You know, it's, I mean, I know you have to be really close to another car in order to be drafting, but... That's that plot twist that he had for Green Arrow. But in this, they don't have that. I mean, you get a really strong impression that this guy is, you know, there's something weird about him. But, you know, you don't quite know what. You think he's just some really narcissistic jerk who is really an unsympathetic person and just, you know, is really misanthropic. Is that that same car that I was calling earlier? Yeah, because it had like a box in the back. So, you know, he just comes off as kind of an abrasive person that maybe has some shady past, and he sets himself up as a suspect early on, but they also set it up that it's a possibility that, you know, someone who is portraying themselves as just being a little Miss Innocent could also be a murderer. So they don't really count anybody out as being murderer. I mean, at one point I was even like, wait, is it possible that it was a police officer who did it? But that doesn't last too long. just kind of like anyone is a suspect. Spend most of the time either in turbulence or just facing the full brunt of the wind. So, I mean, it catches your attention in the sense that you're just evaluating whether or not he's the perp. Really fun necessarily, but, you know, you can think along the same lines of causality. Like, it ends up being that his motive is, I want to be together with you no matter what. I'll kill for you. I will kill other people just so I can have you. I'll even kill you so that I can have you that way. You know, we'll be together in our eventual fate, but, you know, we'll be dead. And if the only way that I can have you is, you know, if the only way for us to be together is by connecting again via murdering, via suicide, then he's like, so be it. You know, so he's an angry person and has a lot of, it's like even when he's showing love, he's showing hate. It's like he hates her for not sticking with him, and he kind of hates her for changing him a little bit. So I would say his character is probably, I mean, it's kind of interesting, but really they should have fleshed out those things about him earlier on, like way earlier, way, way earlier. So I'd say he's sub 32% in terms of being a character. I think he's annoying a lot of the time, but, you know, he could be more annoying than he is. I'd probably just say he's like maybe 28% for his character. I'm not going to do a rolling average, though, for, that's kind of abrupt, for the characters, though, I'm just gonna give, like, a rough approximation after I'm done. Mark's character, you know, he's pretty boring, but, you know, he kind of starts to warm up to things. He just never really shows any of his emotions, and, you know, he tends to be very closed with what he's thinking. But he's clever. Is that this? same guy who was in Sunset Boulevard. I think it might have been. But the actor really isn't, you know, someone who's really that interesting to watch either. So his character ends up being very flat. It's just, he operates more as a vehicle than an actual in-depth character. You know, it's just kind of, he happens to be going along with, it's like, you know, he just kind of casually happens to be influenced by Laura, and just by the circumstances, Laura ends up falling for him. And they're kind of driven together by the circumstances, more than like, you know, some kind of deep personal connection. She's really not that compelling of a person. Like, she doesn't draw you into her personality or anything. She's just kind of one more person. They got a bunch of other characters doing little vignettes. Like, there's just people that Mark knows. Just that are work associates. There's a maid who kind of really bring out who this this character is more. You know, he's Vincent Price's character, or who I think is Vincent Price, I might be wrong about it. He's just someone who doesn't know what he wants, and is kind of a drifter, you know, drifting from one relationship to another. He's been arrested several times in the past, but I think it's more because he's just kind of hopeless and doesn't know what he wants, doesn't have any money, just needs somebody to take care of him. You know, he's good because it's like, you know, he's kind of a fascinating character. It's like, who is this guy? What does he want? And what was his role in the murder? So he's the only one where I would, you know, really more drawn in to trying to figure out more about him. Just because he has enough screen time to where you almost think that he's going to be a supporting cast member, but he's almost a lead. He's probably in the four characters that are in the lead. That would be Lynn Dekker Mark, Laura, and the boyfriend guy. You know, I'll just call him Vincent, because I don't know what his name is. The other interesting character is, okay, so if I were to just grade him by himself, I'd say that he's probably maybe 50%, maybe a little higher, maybe like 52%. So the woman who ends up being the one who actually gets him as a boyfriend, you know, by the end of the movie, her acting is really good. It's almost like, wait, what are you even doing in this movie? It's kind of like when Vincent Price was in Song of Brendan. It's like, your talents are being wasted here. It's a left lane closed road work, I-65 at mile marker 172. What mile marker are we at right now? 169. Yeah, might as well get over now. But his girlfriend is pretty much the same character, except that she's rich, and he's not, but, you know, she realizes he's not rich, but she actually has money, and she's okay with it because he's a good match for her. So the question there is she just a clone of his character, and not really that good of a character herself because of that? She has less screen time. I think the difference between them is that she knows what she wants. But Vincent is just kind of lost. Chicago, a mere 123 miles away. I'm starting to rethink this. Driving as opposed to flying. But no, I've got way too much stuff for that to be feasible. At the 174 mile marker. And actually, I'm not even seeing lane closed. Oh boy. showing to go this way because it's banking left. So, yeah, I mean, she's just kind of less of a character because she's really not in the scene that much, and she really doesn't have that much to do with the story aside from getting Vincent out of the picture. So I'd say her character's not as good. Her acting is great, but her character's just not that important. So I'd put her more at, like, 34%. So overall, most of the characters are boring, or they're unimportant, or they're just fairly flat, and even the flatness of them isn't done well. Alright, well, I still haven't seen any single lane signs, so I think I'm going to get over to the left lane. Get past this wiggly part. So most of the characters seems like they're in the 20s range. There are a few characters that are like in the low 50s. Well, okay, there's one character that's in the low 50s, and then the rest are like down in the 30s. So it sounds like most of the characters are going to be bad. So I'd say like 28% overall.
Chicago.
I thought they said end construction, and now I'm seeing another sign that's a construction sign. That's just a warning about this meeting. Road construction area. Okay, well I guess we're back to this again. Shoulder construction ahead. Alright, I am not going to read every sign, I promise. Character dialogue. Wait, did I write that down? You said 28%, but I didn't actually write it down. I thought once I got up this north, this far north, I'd be done with the people flinging their ashes from their cigarettes out of the car, but apparently I'm going to be sticking with that for a while longer. Character dialogue seems to be pretty bad. I think that the thing where it's like, when I was watching this movie, I was pausing it for other reasons, but one of the reasons, what was that about? That somebody like changed lanes abruptly or something. What just happened? Truck. My knees are cold.